in the inauguration of two-day national conference on language, culture and minorities, issues and challenges. First of all, I will request our distinguished guests to kindly take their seats on the dais. As I know, Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Muhammad Aslam Parvez Sahab is not available because of his busy schedule. I will be requesting Chief Guest of the program, Professor Jacob John Kaiser. Please come on the dais, sir. Keynote speaker, Professor M. Kalam, sir. Guest of honor, Professor Ranu Jain. And Professor P.H. Mohammed, HOD, Department of Sociology, to kindly adorn the stage with their gracious presence. Thank you, sirs and madam. To begin this ceremony, I will invite Muhammad Usman, PhD scholar, CSIP, to recite few verses from Holy Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان الشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر يسجدان والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان ألا تطغوا في الميزان وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان والأرض وضعها للأنام فيها فاكهة والنخل ذات الأكمام والحب ذو العصف والريحان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان صدق الله العظيم.
ترجمة. وہ جو نہایت مہربان ہے اسی نے قرآن کی تعلیم فرمائی, اسی نے انسان کو پیدا کیا, اسی نے اس کو بولنا سکھایا. سورج و چاند ایک حساب مقرر سے چل رہے ہیں اور ستارے اور درخت سزا کر رہے ہیں, اور اسی نے آسمان کو بلند کیا اور میزان عدل قائم کر دی. اس میزان میں سے حد سے تجاوز نہ کرو اور انصاف کے ساتھ تولو اور تول کم مت کرو. اور اسی نے خلقت کے لیے زمین بچھائی, اس میں میوے اور کھجور کے درخت ہیں جن کے خوشوں پر غلاف ہوتے ہیں اور جن کے ساتھ بھس ہوتا ہے اور خوشبودار پھول. تو اے جن و انس, تم اپنے پروردگار کی کون کون سی نعمت کو جھٹلاؤ گے؟ دا موسٹ مرسیفل ٹاٹ دا قرآن کریٹڈ مین, ٹاٹ ہم ایلوکوینس, دا سن اینڈ دا مون موو بائی پریسائز کیلکولیشن, اینڈ دا اسٹارس اینڈ ٹریز پروسٹریٹ, اینڈ دا ہیون ہی ریزڈ اینڈ امپوز دا بیلنس ڈیٹ یو ناٹ ٹرانسگریس ود ان دا بیلنس, اینڈ اسٹیبلش injustice, do not make deficient the balance, and the earth he laid out for the creatures, therein is fruit and palm trees having sheaths of theirs, and grains having husk and scented plants. So which of the favors of your Lord would you deny? Thank you, Salam.
Now it's time to felicitate the guest. May I now kindly request Professor C.H. Mohammed, HOD, Department of Sociology, to honor the chief guest of the program. Conference has been organized to thank you very much, sir. This conference has been organized discuss the issues and challenges faced by the minorities as far as their religion or language is concerned. I will now take the opportunity to invite on podium Professor P.H. Mohammed, HOD Department of Sociology, to deliver welcome address.
We are very happy that we are the Department of Sociology organizing this seminar today, this conference today. First of all, today's chief guest, Professor Jacob John Kattakayam, keynote speaker, Professor M.A. Kalam, today's guest of honor, Professor Ranu Jain, dignitaries, participants who have come all the way from different parts of the country, my dear students, my colleagues, and other IMC friends. Good morning. Assalamu alaikum. I welcome you all. We are grateful to you, sir, for accepting our invitation within a very short notice. It gives me an immense pleasure to invite you all to the today's conference on language, culture, and minorities, issues and challenges, organized by the Department of Sociology, Maulana, Urdu University. Let me say a few words about the Department of Sociology. We are very young and of course a teeny department in the MANUU. And though it is a teeny and young department, we have been excelling and we have been in the forefront with very good academic accomplishments that we have entered in. Our staff have varied experience of teaching and research and have deep engagement with the central sociological issues. We have postgraduate MA degree and PhD research program offered by the Department of Sociology in the university. BA also is there. It's a pass course at graduate level. And of course, with the aim of meeting the mandate of the Maulana Azad Urdu University, the department imparts the knowledge in Urdu, Urdu medium, and thus anticipates transferring sociological knowledge to Urdu society, benefiting the large contingent of Urdu speaking population in India, and thus to take sociology closer to the doorstep of the diverse sociocultural backgrounds. With this, coming to the crux of the today's context, when the proposal was finalized to organize this seminar, I was a bit skeptical whether we will be able to meet this objective, we will be able to meet the demand, that because it's a very short notice. First of all, we have to identify the resource persons, then the participants, all that. But you know, the kind of support my colleagues gave me, Shajia, Sahid, Etesham, and non-teaching staff, was immense. I was really taken over. And following that, the response we got from the participants, inquiring about the seminar, sending abstracts, all that, you know, it was immense. Then later, I can see the people attending the conference, despite of 5-6 conferences in the university, coming and sitting here. I'm really overwhelmed, to say in brief. Of course, in all this, our university administration, particularly our Vice Chancellor, Professor Muhammad Aslam Parvez, Professor Shakil Ahmad, Pro Vice Chancellor of the University, and Dr. Sikandar, Registrar, they gave us enormous support in all, you know, approving the files immediately and sanctioning the things. And also, whenever we go to them, they, without any hesitation, they have sanctioned everything. And I thank them in their absence here on behalf of the Department of Sociology. As the conference theme states, it is on minorities. We felt that we should strike a balance. So you can see the guests sitting on the dais, and particularly from varied backgrounds. And above all, they are an excellent academicians. And once we start reading their profile, briefing their profile, you will be able to know what kind of contribution they have made in the fields of sociology, and in particular, and other sociological issues, social science issues in general. We have Professor Jacob John Kattakayam, Professor M.A. Kalam, and Professor Ranu Jain, who have contributed immensely to the fields of sociology and to that of the theme of the present conference. Friends, the conference theme has two dimensions basically. One is discussing the contestations and construction of minority and majority languages and the sociological groups associated with this. In fact, this has the contestations and constructions has been a continuous debate, and it's a recurring phenomena in India, and of course in a way it formed basis for it has been construed and formed basis for, you know, constructing Indians Indian society on linguistics lines after independence. Thus, also we find a literature gap in this area, particularly it belongs to the poor sociological ilk. Then we found that there is lack of literature in this particular area, particularly contributed by the sociologists. We thought, let there be some debate, let us raise the curtain. So we thought that this seminar will be ideal, this conference on this particular theme will raise some interest among the sociologists across the country. And thus we must have seen in the brochure also that we thought of combining both the young research scholars, young scholars and the senior scholars, so as to bring them to a platform and finding a way to continuing research in this area. And of course, as I said, it generated enormous interest, and we have got almost 70 abstracts, out of which we have rejected some, and finally we restricted them to 55 or 60, and all these abstracts we have divided into 5 to 6 themes, sub-themes, and we have arranged them into different sessions in the conference. Besides this, we have one plenary session immediately after this inaugural function, where, you know, senior and good academicians are participating and deliberating on the issue concerning one of the sub-themes. Then we have one invited panel tomorrow, where again we have invited young scholars to strike a balance. One is plenary session where senior academicians will be participating. The invited panel where, you know, moderately and rising academicians are participating. So these all, and in response to our abstracts, we have got response from, in response to our call for papers, we have got response from different universities, starting from JNU Delhi, Jamia Millia Islamia, Aligarh Muslim University, Hyderabad Central University, IIT Mumbai, then Kerala University, and Hyderabad Central University. We have some people from TIS also, and there are some representatives from Gujarat Central Universities. So it is really a national conference. So I don't want to stand in between the speakers. They are eminent speakers sitting on the dais. With this brief introduction, I will take leave. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you for coming from various parts of the society, from different institutes. And within the short notice, I thank you on the behalf of the Department of Sociology and on behalf of the University, MANUU. Thank you once again for coming all the way. Before I request Professor Kattakayam to come and occupy the podium, I will introduce him briefly. Professor Jacob John Kattakayam is a professor emeritus at the University of Kerala and also past president of the Indian Sociological Society. He is also the honorary director of the Center for Gerontological Studies. He was the director cum professor of the UGC Academic Staff College, University of Kerala, for over 12 years and Dean Faculty of Social Sciences. He was a member of the ICSR, secretary of the Indian Sociological Society for 2 terms, and the visitor's nominee to the Faculty of Education, University of Delhi. He has produced 37 PhDs. He has served as visiting professor at the University of Southern California, USA, Montclair State University, New Jersey, USA. He has also served as visiting faculty in the Morgan State University, USA, and Duke University, North Carolina, and has visited several universities in USA, Canada, Europe, South Africa, South America, Australia, Africa, and Asia, and delivered lectures there. He has presented papers and chaired sessions at the Second World Forum of Sociology, Vienna, held in 2016, and also World Congress of Sociology, Yokohama, Japan, International Federation of Aging Workshop, Istanbul, 20th World Congress Gerontology, Seoul, World Forum of the International Rural Network, Vajala, Australia, 17th World Congress of Sociology, Sweden. He has also presented papers at the 18th World Congress of Gerontology, Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, and also in the 4th International Conference on Rural Networking, Abingdon, Virginia, USA. He has also participated in the 5th International Conference of Association of Anthropology and Gerontology, University of Texas, Austin, and also in the 11th World Congress of Sociology in Madrid, Spain. He was selected by the UNFPA to attend an international workshop on social gerontology in Malta and an international workshop on health expectancy of Nikon University, Tokyo. Friends, the Ministry of Human Resource Development at the invitation of the South African government had nominated Professor Kattakayam to present the country paper at the academic seminar held in connection with IBSA summit in Johannesburg on 15th to 17th, 2007. He has authored 4 books, edited 4, and is with IBSA and is series editor for the 7 Diamond Jubilee volumes of the Indian Sociological Society. He was re-elected to the Executive Committee of the International Sociological Association, RC11, and to the Board of Directors of International Rural Network, Canada. Recently, he has attended the open-ended working group on aging at the UN headquarters, New York, and addressed the UN General Assembly for the 2nd time. Professor Jacob John Kattakayam has also presented paper at the international conference organized by the ISA RC11 on aging families and Syracuse University, USA, and World Forum of Sociology in Vienna, July 2016. Friend, this shows the eminent personality who is amongst us. I invite him to deliver his speech. Please.
Esteemed keynote speaker, Professor M. Kalam, guest of honor, Professor Ranu Jain, Professor Muhammad, P.H. Muhammad, head of the Department of Sociology, Dr. Shahid, Professor Shahida, Dean, Dr. Shasia Fasli, other faculty members from this university as well as from other universities in India, Professor Scholars, students, and my dear friends. First of all, I would like to congratulate the Department of Sociology for organizing a national conference on a very important theme. Actually, 2 years back, I was here as a member of the NACPR team to assess this university, and at that time, I have suggested to have the All India Sociological Conference in this university to the then President, Professor Sujata Patel. Anyway, that didn't click due to various reasons, and I hope that this may be a rehearsal for Mr. Muhammad to organize an All India Sociological Conference in the coming years, and this will help him a lot in doing such things. Definitely, there is enough infrastructure for this university, and that is the reason that second time also you have got A grade from the NAC accreditation. And of course, again, this type of opportunity, this type of activities will definitely help the university to secure more scores at the next stage of accreditation, which is waiting maybe after 2 or 3 years. So as far as this theme is concerned, really, I am indeed honored to be here amidst you to share some of my views on the theme of your conference, which I think are not just important, but imperative as far as the future directions of India as a nation is concerned. Because we know that there are a lot of new trends are emerging in our society, which we never heard in the past. An outsider may wonder what binds Indians together, but we share some magic bonds that glued us together in the last 7 decades of our journey as a democratic polity. Because we all speak about the unity in diversity. Of course, we were experiencing in the past, whenever there is a common threat comes, definitely all Indians were united. And now the situation is slowly, I doubt, I have a reasonable apprehension in mind that there is a reasonable deviation from that age-old concept of unity in diversity, because people are divided than ever before on various reasons. Anthropologists define culture in a variety of ways, and the definition usually includes some notion of shared values, beliefs, expectations, customs, and rituals. And language as a set of common sounds and symbols by which individuals communicate. We Indians don't share any of them in common. However, the need for a common language is a necessity created by modern democratic societies, which is driven by aspirations of universal mobilization of the common people. At the time of the French Revolution, you'll be wondering that only 50% of the French people were speaking French as their official language and in the correct form of French, as we witness today. The same was the case with Italy also. There, out of 100, only 2 or 3 were speaking pure Italian. There are Sicilian and other dialects and other forms of languages or dialects were prevailing in those countries at that time. So this means that most of our past, we have lived in an oral universe, wherein the role of a written common language was very minimal. However, later, the original case for a standard language was entirely out of democratic reasons and not for a cultural one. The question was, how could citizens understand, let alone take part in the governance of their country, if it was conducted in an incomprehensible language? Therefore, for the founders of the original nation states, the unity of the nation was political and not socio-anthropological. It consisted in the decision of a sovereign people to live under common laws and a common constitution, irrespective of culture, language, and ethnic composition. A nation is the totality of individuals united by living under a common law and represented by the same legislative assembly. There were other attempts to define nation based on many criteria, like, for example, religion. However, a viable and durable cultural renewal through the democratic route can only be achieved through a pluralistic path, characterized by the dignified coexistence of different identity groups. Religion is particularly ill-suited to serve as basis for national cultural renewal, because while a nation is necessarily territorially anchored, the central tendency of religious communities has been territorial spread. Territorialization of religion will invariably lead to hegemonization by the majority and the consequent collective alienation of minority religions and communalization of all religions. Additionally, the above processes, hegemonization, collective alienation, communalization, will prompt cultural relativism, the tendency to preserve and revive cultural purity, all of which create an exclusionary ethos in society. India is a multinational state. It is a conglomeration of many nations coexisting under one polity. Given this empirical reality, language alone can be the basis of Indian renewal. Language is critical for basic mental processes such as thinking, understanding, and even for dreaming. Arguments for preserving linguistic diversity in terms of protecting and promoting languages and prevailing linguistic rights can be classified into three broad streams, namely identity-based, justice-based, diversity-based arguments. I am not going to touch in detail because the keynote speaker is here, because he is a very famous anthropologist, and definitely he will be able to throw light on all those aspects. India was a British colony for 200 years, and the colonial cultural importations have mutilated the purity of Indian society. It is necessary to cleanse the system of these undesirable accretions. All traditions are characterized by both assets and liabilities. There will be assets as well as liabilities, as far as any tradition, if you examine, we'll be able to find out. Indian tradition is no exception. Similarly, no model of modernization is capable of bringing about social transformation without enormous social costs. Therefore, the real challenge of Indian renewal is selective retention of the assets in its rich tradition, as well as judicial borrowing of the valuable elements in different models of modernization. Mark, the Indian tradition is not conceived here in unilinear terms, but as product of the long evolution of synthesis of different cultural streams. As it operates today, it would be extremely difficult to identify purely Hindu, pre-Aryan, Islamic or Western elements in it. They had into the organic whole over a long period of time through the process of accretion. Further, the elements of modernity can be adopted from different contexts and gradually adapted to the Indian milieu. The acceptance or rejection of a cultural item should not be guided by the locale of its origin, but it is its feasibility for the purpose at hand. The tradition is at test, the hegemony of the cultural mainstream, the nationalists advocate the hegemony of the state, and the modernists endorse the hegemony of the market and technology. So in sharp contrast to the above pluralistic perspective, explicitly endorses the coexistence of different cultures within the same polity and dignity. The pluralist assumption is that to be different does not imply inferiority or superiority, and hence the need and possibility of the coexistence of culture. Two caveats should, however, be added. First, cultural pluralism should not be mistaken for cultural relativism, which could be invoked to justify slavery, racism, and Nazism, because Robert Redfield has mentioned it very clearly. And in order to preserve the purity of the cultures. Then secondly, while cultural pluralism implies internationalism, the real issues of coexistence of nations and ethnic groups operate within and not across polities. Therefore, in India, it is true that language is the most viable and pertinent of all bases for an authentic renewal of the Indian polity. However, by language, I mean not only officially recognized and developed languages, but mother tongues including dialects. Experience the world over clearly demonstrate that communication is imperative in order to bring about participatory development. Adequate and appropriate communication is very effective through the languages of the people, their mother tongues, etc. Administrative units to be viable and effective ought to be coterminous with the communication units, that is linguistic areas. Then language is generally speaking directly linked to a specific territory, and these together provide the basis for common lifestyle and communication pattern. Most languages, irrespective of their status, are capable of effective communication in the context of everyday life. It may not be possible, even desirable, to establish separate administrative units for all the linguistic units wherever it is viable and feasible. It is desirable to establish such units like panchayats or districts or states. Then finally, if the constitutional guarantee of imparting universal compulsory primary education in the mother tongue is faithfully implemented, the single step will substantially contribute to the eradication of illiteracy and more efficient communication, thereby accelerating the process of development. Presently, the majority of the Indians receive primary education in foreign languages, that is languages other than their mother tongues. That is the case as far as many countries concerned. So as far as the present scenario is concerned, India accepts social, cultural and linguistic diversity, but in the centralizing tendency of the state, this principled acceptance of diversity is often swallowed by the eagerness to homogenize and create a single identity. Even Jawaharlal Nehru made this mistake with his initial objection, of what later he has convinced, to linguistic states and the imposition of Hindi. Planned development and the continuance of many colonial laws designed for crushing dissent and giving state enormous social and economic power over citizens. Even within states, we find similar tendencies where linguistic, caste, and religious minorities are marginalized over time, making the identity politics very relevant in our democracy for social assertion and political survival. In 1991, economic reforms have, on one hand, hastened the marginalization of minorities and created a fresh impetus for homogenization as against diversity. Yet, the 44 years delay after independence in adopting liberalization and globalization in 1991 also gave some time for new instincts to develop. So we have cultural nationalism in the form of Hindutva, Islamist assertions among a section of Muslims, the rise of backward class politics, opposition to big dams and land acquisition, and concurrent to all this, the fragmentation of politics and rise of political parties representing regional, caste and religious interests. These have forced the political and intellectual class to accept the wide diversity of India, and yet the project to locate a single and common national history religion, language, and culture continues without fail. So the pressures and counter-pressures will continue for a long time, but it may be futile to depend on the state in its current form or the market to adopt policies that encourage diversity. It will lie with the academia, activists, and civil society in its various trappings to articulate the demands of linguistic and cultural minorities. We are seeing centralization of homogenization on several fronts and sectors like taxation and education through GST, NEET, NCERT, etc. The dominance of English and Hindi in our national system of education is putting students groomed in other languages at a distinct disadvantage But everyone seems to have accepted that such centralization with due regard paid to some of the dominant official languages will help to overcome the stronger political opponents. Over the years, this is how many states have treated the problems of linguistic minorities and multiple dialects. Opposition to cultural imposition within a state is usually milder than central imposition. The language textbooks in Tamil, Hindi, Malayalam, Telugu, etc. coaches children in a unitary form of the language, while dialects survive merely on the strength of its spoken numbers. Cultural products like cinema, books, media, etc. tend to aid the textbook homogenization. I am going to conclude. Language, culture, identity, etc. are fluid and dynamic. While we seem to be moving in the direction of homogeneity, it is to be noted that globalization is facing strong attacks and global trade is becoming disrupted. Communities are erecting walls and barriers, and these can tend to act as protectionism of language, culture, religion, ethnicity, etc. Both minorities and majorities can tend to show such instincts to close ranks. But where they become majoritarianism, it is certain to take the form of violence against minorities. So the challenge before us is to decide whether a balance is needed between homogenization and preservation of diversity, whether too much of one thing can lead to dangers of violence towards the other, inverted commas, in an environment mediated by political and economic forces. We also need to highlight the importance of dialogue between cultures, between majorities and minorities, the dangers posed by aging society, and how farm distress, climate change, jobless growth are creating new fissures, lessening old divides. Areas where sociologists have to give more concentration. Of course, we know that influence of caste is still in our Indian politics, because we know, I don't think anybody, any point of time, this will change, because it is increasing. That is a tendency we can say. I conclude by saying that this is a very relevant topic. I really congratulate the Department of Sociology, Professor Mohammed and his colleagues, for selecting a very relevant topic and conducting a national seminar with a lot of participants from different parts of the country, from Kerala to Kenya, Kashmir, like the Kashmir also, I think, participated. Yeah, Kerala to Kashmir, because it's really, I congratulate you. I hope that the department will grow further, and you will gain strength in organizing the All India Sociological Conference in the coming future. I wish the department and this university all the best for inviting me here.
You have flashed an outlook of the present scenario, the Indian situation. You have called for a dialogue between the communities. And thank you very much, and thank you for offering us to organize the Indian Sociological Society conference next time. Now, before I invite Professor M.A. Kalam to deliver his keynote address, I will introduce his biodata. Professor M.A. Kalam is in social sciences at Laila Institute of Business Administration. He was a professor and head department of anthropology, also chairing chairperson, that is Dean, School of Social Sciences, and adjunct professor, Center for Ocean and Coastal Studies at the University of Madras. He was a professor of humanities at Tejpur Central University, Assam, before he came and joined as professor at Social Sciences at LIBA. He has been a Rockefeller Resident Fellow at Duke University and Human at Harvard University. Commonwealth Fellow at the London School of Economics. He has taught and in the institutions in Europe, US, Middle East and East Asian countries. Has published over 65 books. He was governing council member of the ICSR also. At present, he is a member in NAC peer team. He was the member of the high committee set up by the Ministry of Minority Affairs, Government of India, to develop a diversity index. In the wake of the Sachar Committee report, you know that diversity index committee was Professor Kundu. He was aware of that. He wrote a column during the 90s for the Hindu business line, consumer consumption behavior. Professor Kalam has conducted anthropological field among the South Asian communities in England, France, and US. This is the experience for the person among us now, and I invite him to deliver his keynote speech today. Thank you, sir.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much for having me today, and not the first time that I have been in this hall. 6 years back, I had given a public lecture here, this very hall, and that was also incidentally organized by Professor Muhammad, who was at that time the Center for Social Exclusion, and I had the privilege of speaking in this hall. So at that time, December, the month of December, it wasn't so long. So I think my talk is not going to heat it up further. So I hope that it may be provoked to you, because I'm taking a stand which is completely different from what the others would normally take. By training, I'm a social anthropologist, and therefore I speak something from a different perspective today. And that's because of the fact that if you can look at the topic which is there, it may differ slightly from what you are expecting. And I won't be doing a textbook and analysis for language, culture and minorities. I will differ from that and put up something in terms of what is needed today. Academics are there not just for teaching in the classroom in terms of saying what is there in the book, but also I think there has to be some kind of an activism in terms of what they could do for people to provoke if something is happening to them in the given current political situation. And therefore, let me also say that sometimes terms mean different things to different people. So when I'm using the term fascism here, by that I mean an authoritarian, nationalistic, right-wing system of government and social organization. That's a very preliminary kind of a thing I could give to say as to what I mean by fascism. It's an extreme right-wing, authoritarian or intolerant views or practices of people. That's when fascism comes in. It was first used in the totalitarian and nationalistic of Benito Mussolini from 1922 to 1933, and then the Nazi Germany and Franco Spain also had the fascist kind of tendencies. And fascism tends to include a belief in the supremacy of one national or ethnic group, a contempt for democracy, an insistence on obedience to a powerful leader, and a strong demagogic approach. So that's what fascism means. Therefore, I think we need to have a kind of definition, and that's the kind of definition that I would give when I'm talking about fascism today. So when I'm talking about minorities, somebody can easily point out that you may be talking about one minority. Therefore, let me, I think, as a kind of a caveat, first say that I'm aware of the fact that the religious minorities in the country are six. The Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, and Jains are religious minorities. Besides that, when we talk about minorities, we also have women, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, the LGBT, all included in that. And therefore, I'm using the word minorities here as a metaphor for those who are weak, helpless, and vulnerable. So that's why I think I'm not going to say that, don't take up criticism by saying that by minorities you're talking only about Muslims. I'm not. There are some quotations which I'll be giving, where the word Muslim may come in, and that's not because I emphasize only on the Muslims. As I said, basically what I mean vocation is a group of people who are vulnerable, a group of people who are weak, a group of people who are being oppressed. These are the ones that we talk about as minorities, irrespective of the number. It is not necessary. Therefore, the Muslims may constitute 14%, the Christians may constitute less than 3%, the Sikhs may constitute something less. So if you remember 1984, because of the fact that such thing happened, they were also completely vulnerable. And therefore, my point is that academics in general, not just social scientists, have to stand up to injustices which are happening and oppression which is happening amongst them. And therefore, in the presentation, what I would do is, there is a phrase which I'm not sure how many of you are aware of or how many of you know about, what is known as speaking truth to power. As people who have the voice and as people who have pen or the typewriter or the laptop with them today, are you speaking to power? By power, you mean the people, the political class in the country. And are you speaking up to them? That's something I think which is important. It's not just enough if I'm going to be in the classroom and talk to my students. I think even there, when I'm talking to my students, what do I do? I just tell them what they're in the different books or make them aware fact that there are certain things happening to them and therefore they have to stand up against it. And last month, sorry for making a personal thing here, but I think it's important because this shows the kind of reaction you get to speak up something. Vice chancellors in Tamil Nadu, two of them were arrested because of corruption charges, and one of them was arrested red hand for accepting 30 lakh rupees for one single appointment. I had 80 appointments. So, you do calculations. I'm bad at mathematics. Okay, the other person was also arrested because of the corruption charges which were there. And NDTV wanted to run a program on that, and they came and asked me if I would be able to speak on that. And that interview is available. I think Mohammed also has that interview. The entire interview, it was recorded and it was telecast by NDTV, where I took up a position that while I was at Madras University for about 35 years, I have seen people who cannot write a sentence and people who cannot speak a minute being appointed. Short of the names, I gave everything. Now, the reaction was some of the people who were very happy about the interview, but there were others who said, why are you taking up this kind of a stand? Why are you sticking your neck out? Do you have to talk about these things? And you have a wife, you have a daughter, you have a family. Why do you have to do this? Now, that's where the whole question comes in, whether you want to be oppressed in spite of the fact that you have a voice. In that interview, I could have subdued everything and talked about how they were wrongly taken, the context was wrong. This is not what I mean. All kinds of justifications could have been given by saying that these people were framed. Anything could have gone in. But the fact that I took a stand, and I had personal knowledge of the kind of people who have been appointed by people taking money in the University of Madras, and the only two phases when Malcolm Adishesha was the Vice Chancellor and two short phases when the university grew. Otherwise, it was downhill. Now, that's the kind of point I'm making when I say that people who have got the power as being academics, do they have in them to talk, speaking, what is known as speaking truth to power? This phrase came up in a completely different context among the Quakers in the United States during the 1950s. And I am using it in order to provoke people to take up a stand whenever or wherever they can. So the other point that I would like to make is that language, culture, and the minorities, as my good friend Professor John Katakam has pointed out, is something which is there in the realm of the anthropologist for a very long time. And I don't want to dwell on that because there is something, quite a lot written about that, and that you will find anyway. I will just say one thing, that languages are embedded in cultures. If you take them out of context, for instance, to explain something, or even use the phrases, I will give you two phrases, for instance, which is relevant today. Suppose Muhammad says a warm welcome to you. It has no meaning at all. In a place where the language developed, in England, for instance, when everything is cold, you provide something warm, people are happy. And when you are doing something to your house, you do housewarming ceremony. In a place like Hyderabad during May, if somebody says warm welcome, you are stupid. If somebody says you are having a housewarming ceremony, there is something wrong with you. And therefore, languages are so embedded in cultures that we cannot sometimes take them out of context, but we have this use of a habit thing. None of us, I'm sure, hardly any of us takes a bath. And I mean specifically the word bath. You have a wash or you have a shower. Bath means you either do it in a river or you do it in a tub. But 24 hours we use the word bath. So I'm just giving this to make the context relevant to you that languages develop in cultures, and if you take them out, it has a lot of different kind of a meaning. But I'm not going to dwell further into that because I know there are quite a few sessions, about 6 sessions or something, and there are scholars who are going to dwell on that, and they will talk about language and culture and other things. But what is, I think, important for me and the way I look at it, some of you may disagree with this, is that what's happening to us in terms of political, social, economic, and cultural context today is something I think which we have to look into, and that's what I'm trying to do today. And I may have to read up parts of the paper because given my fascination for going off the handle very easily, if I don't stick to the theme, I think you will have to sit here whole day. And this is not something which would be a very warm kind of a welcome to do. So if the air conditioner works extra efficiently, as extra superly, then maybe you will warm up, or warming up would be necessary. So let me digress a bit from the lighter vein and go something into one of the facts which hardly anybody is today is aware of, even in academics. In England, during 1932, a member of parliament called Sir Oswald Emerald Mosley, who died in 1980, had started something known as the British Union of Fascists. I'm not sure how many people are aware of it. There was an officially recognized party known as the British Union of Fascists. They were also known as the Black Shirts. And this happened in a place which today talks about liberty, fraternity, and all kinds of nonsense. And he was a member of the parliament who did this, and he was knighted. He was Sir Oswald. And this ran for quite some time, but they realized in 1936 that this was something which a country like England should not have. And then they banned the party through what is known as the Public Order Act of 1936. Now, officially having something called a Union of Fascists is something which happened in a place which later tried to give different kinds of, I think, tutorials for people in India to talk about justice and fair play. Now, ever since the BJP came to power in 2014, we have seen beatings, bullying, burning, lynching of people in the country, and that too blatantly. Now, how a group acts and behaves in a given context depends on the kind of moral or political backing that the group has got. And they do it totally manifestly today. So the extrajudicial attacks which are happening and which are perpetrated on our fellow citizens so brazenly will not ensue unless the stormtroopers and the so-called fringe groups feel assured of backing and protection from the highest quarters. And the silence at the top bestows legitimacy on these fringers to run riot in our villages, towns, and cities. Now, in January, in an editorial in the Economic and Political Weekly, there was something which came up, and it was trying to tell us that both from above, by means of some institutions of the state, and from below, through the Hindutva Brigade, a determined effort is being made in the country to reorder the society and polity along the lines of Hindutva, thereby posing a grave danger to democracy and secularism. This is from 27th of January 2018, in editorial in the Economic and Political Weekly. That is what they're arguing. And this is something which very few journals, very few newspapers are doing. The other journal or newspaper which is taking up some kind of a stand on this is the Hindu, but in a very subtle way. The Hindu has got, for those of you who may not be aware of it, what is known as the Hindu Center for Politics and Public Policy. And it's an online kind of a thing where they publish some very good articles. And incidentally, for those of you who are interested in a couple of things that I wrote, which takes up something from what I'm speaking today, there are two articles. One is to show that diversity is not pluralism. And the article online, which is available, the title is Towards Genuine Pluralism. So they published this in November. And then to commemorate, to condemn the 25 years of the Babri Masjid, they asked me, it was a solicited article again, to write something on what happened to a person who was a social scientist, but doing field work in a different culture at that time. I was doing field work among the Indians and Pakistanis in Bradford in England for about a year. And so they wanted to know what was the reaction of the community to the Babri Masjid demolition. And this is titled The Winter of Anguish. Both of these are available. And the point I'm trying to make here is that when the state gives legitimacy for people to act in a particular way, you will have certain things which develop, which has happened in a separate field. For instance, there is what is known as corporate social responsibility, where those who have got a certain budget have to give about 2% of their earnings towards that kind of a responsibility. Now, as a contrary thing which has happened since the BJP came to power is that what I use, this is a term on which I have a copyright, corporate lynching responsibility. Certain groups have developed what is known as corporate lynching responsibility. Now, you don't develop this kind of an attitude unless the state supports certain of the activities which are happening. And therefore, this is something which needs to be condemned. And I will move to one of the other factors which is there. For 4.5 years, I don't think there's any country, including the criticism which was there against Manmohan Singh, that there has been not a single press conference where the Prime Minister has spoken to the people and defended in terms of doing it from the journalistic point of view, or holding a press conference and taking up questions. Not one single press conference has been addressed by the Prime Minister. And he was criticizing, and the entire BJP and RSS was criticizing Manmohan Singh by calling him the silent Gudiya or Mohan Gudiya, whatever. But he has not done that. On the other hand, he has what is known as the Man Ki Baat, which is on the state-controlled medium, which is there. And in Man Ki Baat, and some people call it unilateral harangue, and that he goes on unilaterally without anybody responding to what you are saying, and whose man it is and whose bath it is, you don't know. So this has been going on, and for 4 years has not done anything. And every year there is something very interesting which happens in Chennai. And even though I was living in Assam, I would come during January for that. And this has gone into the 8th, 9th year this time, called the Hindu Literary Festival. It's known as the Lit for Life, Literature for Life Festival, conducted by Hindu over 3 days. Now, during January when it happened, Teesta settled what? And I'm sure everybody knows Teesta. If you don't, then the fault is. During the last 4 years, 63 people. Now, this is something official. Those of you who want can go to the Hindu website and check up something. So one of the first lynching incidents which happened, am I disturbing somebody? Thank you for giving me the break, but it's not a commercial one. Okay, one of the first lynchings took place was in Pune. Sheikh Mohsin was beaten to death on the 2nd of January 2014, in about a week after BJP had come to power in May 2014. Now, by now we're getting used to the fact that people are being lynched. But the point is something which happened at the judiciary. There was a lady called Justice Murdula Bhatkar of the Bombay High Court. And she gave a judgment by releasing these people on bail, saying that the problem was with the victim. He belonged to a wrong religion. And that's why he was beaten up. And she further, I will read up if you want the quotation. I consider this factor in favor of the accused. Moreover, the accused do not have any criminal record, and it appears that in the name of religion, they were provoked and have committed the murder. This is the high court judge in the country making a thing that the problem was with the victim because he belonged to a wrong religion. And therefore, he was beaten to death. But on the 15th of February, the Supreme Court bench consisting of Justice Bobde and Nageshwar Rao overturned that. And then they said that it was a very drastic kind of a statement that she had made. And they emphasized the fact that the deceased Mohsin belonged to a certain community cannot be a justification for any assault, much less a murder. They further stated that a court should be fully conscious of the plural composition of the country while called upon to deal with the rights of various communities. And this is something, I think, the right-thinking people, but still, how many of you have seen the media or even the television, the electronic media, going against this judgment or talking about it or protesting against the judgment which was made? And that's what is happening in fascism. That is, the media succumbs to it. They are bought up by people like the Reliance, that the companies like Reliance and the others, and they go silent. And therefore, a journal like EPW or something which happens in the Hindu comes as a kind of a light at the end of the tunnel when you see that these things are pointed out. And this is something which is on record. Again, you can find it from the EPW, that this woman had the guts to say that the person was murdered because he happened to be a Muslim. Now, if this happens at the High Court, you can imagine what's happening at the lower courts. And just to give again an example of Tamil Nadu, some of the lower court judges are being dismissed by the High Court, and that's just a minuscule of what is happening. And let me also point out as to what happens in the High Courts of the country, where in Rajasthan, one of the judges of the High Court went on record to say that the peacocks and the peahens, the peacock makes the peahen pregnant by making the peahen drink the tears of the peacock. And that's what he was giving a lesson in biology and zoology to people as to how the peacocks have progeny. And probably, I think, the way the state is going on, the same thing will happen now. Husbands and wife can live separately, but send tears to each other, and the women can get pregnant. If it happens among the peacocks, why not happen among the humans? At a certain point, give another 5 years from 2019, probably that's what will happen. Now, as per the recent status report of the Ministry of Home Affairs, 111 people were killed and 2,384 were injured during 2017 in 822 communal incidents. Now, this is an increase from 2016, which had witnessed 751 communal incidents. Now, the vigilante groups which are there, and they're picking up invariably the Dalits and the minority communities for what they think is considered as a wrong. Now, let me again revert to the EPW. Harsh Mandar, I'm sure some of you know the name. Harsh Mandar and 66 other retired IAS officers, civil servants, have written a letter, and the letter is titled as Violence Against Minorities. This is as of 3rd of February 2018. And they say, I am quoting, "We retired civil servants belonging to different services and batches wish to register our deep concern at the continuing incidents of mindless violence in the country, especially those targeting the minorities, and the lackadaisical response of the law enforcement machinery to these attacks." They further say, "Apart from murders, we are deeply concerned to see the acceleration of a process of ghettoization through organized resistance to sale of properties for Muslims." Now, they're talking about an incident which happened in Meerut at a locality called Maliwara, where a Muslim buyer was prevented from taking possession of the property which had already been bought by the person. Now, historically, one can cite innumerable examples where the dominant groups as well as individuals have consistently made attempts to subdue the others. I'm using the word others in a special sense here. And the others are the minority and the marginalized sections for umpteen reasons and in very many different ways, including through exclusions. What underlies such exercises is also the running thread of economic exploitation, political disempowerment, and cultural marginalization, often with the complicity of the state. While exploitation, marginalization, and exclusion have taken different forms in different places at different times, depending on the nature and structure of the society in a particular setup, unbridled subjugation has been worse when state collusion occurs. Early historical and quite well-known examples are from the ancient Greek setup, where the term hegemony develops. And in this setup, there were different groups, some were dominant and some had subjugated the others. But I'm using this example to show that the word hegemony developed during the period in Greek city-states like Athens, Sparta, and Thebes, where regional and national or transnational differences were present in plural, complex, and multicultural societies. But that's where the term comes in. When you start hegemonizing the other group, it leads to different kinds of problems, and we have been having. Now, there have been counter-hegemonic examples which point towards upward economic mobility as a requisite vital base before social mobility is sought. Now, this is something I think I would like to dwell upon a bit, because unless a group of people are economically mobile in terms of having certain things which they don't have earlier, social mobility becomes a different kind of, becomes a difficult kind of thing to achieve. And I can give examples from the religious conversion studies which have happened in Tamil Nadu from 1981 and from the time what is known as the Meenakshipuram conversion happened in 1981. I have been lucky to get grants to do these studies from 1982 onwards in Meenakshipuram and other places in Tamil Nadu. And one of the important things which has happened there is that the groups which have been economically mobile are the ones which are rebelling against the existing social order and go against the existing practices which are in the villages or the towns. Those who are dependent on people who supply them something in terms of their daily livelihood, dependent on their land, working as landless laborers, or depending on them for wage labor, they cannot do. And therefore, when we take up the profile of the villages where religious conversions have taken place, you see that there are people who have gone out of the village and have had education in places like Madurai, Tirunelveli, Chennai, these places. And having gone there, they have experienced anonymity, and they have experienced certain things which don't happen to them in the village. And when they go back to the village, they are not ready to accept the existing social order. And these are the people who rebel. And Joan Mencher had done a study in Chingalpet long time back where she showed that those who question the existing social order in a group or in a place are the people who have spent time out, who are economically mobile, and who have been exposed to different kinds of practices. And that's one of the positive things which happened in the oppressive caste system in India, that 25, 30 miles, you go out of your own villages, you have certain amount of anonymity. People do not know who you are. And that's where I think caste system, in a very, very surreptitious way, I always talk about this to my students and point out these things, that caste system is positive because of certain anonymity which could be got, which does not happen in race. If you are black in a racist kind of a system, irrespective of where you live in the country or go out of the country, in your own village or everywhere, 24/7 your face, your physical features show that you belong to that race, and therefore you are targeted throughout. So the positive thing is, and this is what Ambedkar had been talking about. Ambedkar had been advocating, as opposed to Gandhi, that the Dalits, he did not use the word Dalit. He was more fond of using the word broken people. And the Dalit becomes current as a term only during the 1970s when the Dalit Panthers came up in the Bombay area. And then the term has now become synonym with scheduled caste. But the word Dalit, if you look at it from the Marathi point of view, it means the oppressed. So anybody can be a Dalit. I can be a Dalit. Women can be Dalits. Scheduled tribes can be Dalits. But that's the origin of the term as to how it comes in and how it's used today is different. And Gandhi and Ambedkar were quite opposed on this, where Gandhi was urging people to go for the villages, start off rural industries and different kinds of handicrafts and the other things. And Ambedkar thought that the future for the Dalits lay in places away from the villages. He was exhorting people to go out, and then he said that if you are going away from the rural areas, you will have more anonymity and you will have more freedom and you will have more space to operate. So this is something which happens in the caste system. And if you are in a hall like this or sitting in a cinema hall or traveling by a bus or a train, you do not know who the other is. The other becomes recognized only when you are in a small first-hand contact kind of a setup in a small locality. Once you are out of that locality, you have certain anonymity which comes in. And if you do not mind, let me again go back to something which I found very interesting, again from the Economic and Political Weekly editorial. And the editorial says, presently, there are many Muslim youth who have been through acute suffering at the hands of the police and the criminal justice system. This is as of February. Indeed, the forces of Hindutvadi nationalism, with the active complicity of the state, have been bent upon humiliating and crushing Muslims. The police and the courts, and these are the kind of courts I'm talking about, the woman from Bombay and the Rajasthan thing. The police and the courts have by and large failed to provide protection and deliver justice, so much so that a considerable section of the community seems to be losing faith in these arms of the state. Now, when that happens, there are other things which happen. When people lose faith in the law and order machinery, you develop parallel kind of things. And those of you who have, sorry if I have to give you an example from a novel or a movie, seen Godfather, or those of you who are aware of the culture of poverty studies in anthropology, will know that when you are denied certain participation in the state machinery or the organs of the state, you develop parallel kind of a thing. You cannot participate in the banking system because you do not have a collateral and you don't have one Modi supporting another Nirav Modi. And therefore, what you have to do is go to other kinds of sources. Therefore, people have what are known as women organized chit funds and the other things amongst themselves because they cannot go to the bank. If you go to the bank, they will ask you collateral. But if Modi goes to the bank, the name is enough. Nobody will ask you collateral. Nothing can be a bigger collateral than the name Modi today in the country. And therefore, what happens is that if you cannot, if the state law and order and the state machinery does not allow you to do certain things, you develop parallel kind of organizations. Sometimes it takes, I think, drastic forms, and then you start talking about minorities and the others indulging in different kinds of activities. Now, since we are talking about the Prime Minister here, let me also point out that there's a lady called Swati Chaturvedi. I don't know how many of you are aware of this person. Swati Chaturvedi has been doing a study of the digital army of the BJP. She has published a book on that, and she was also there. I was lucky to have some kind of interaction with her in the last Hindu Life for Literary Festival in Chennai. She has pointed out that the Prime Minister follows 42 abusive handles. I'm not sure how many of you are aware of what's happening on the social media, and everybody is aware today of the social media. But the fact that 99% of the news and the other things is either hate or fake, people are not aware of that. Two four-letter words, fake and hate, amongst other four-letter words. So this is something which is happening on the social media. And therefore, Modi officially is following 42. And the functioning in India of these vigilantes has become a cause for concern for the civil society in general and the left-leaning and the liberal public in the country in particular. Now, this is something you don't expect from a person who is at the helm, who got a big majority and then has been doing something which is completely undesirable. And please note down the name Swati Chaturvedi, and she's doing, I think, a fantastic job, spending almost 18 to 19 hours of her time looking at how the BJP's digital army is trying to put down the others by bringing up all kinds of hate material in the social media. Now, given the kind of society and polity we live in, it's inconceivable that intellectuals in particular and the civil society in general will rise and voice their concern to the authorities and establishments that all is not well in our daily lives, that our lives are being throttled through shrill outcries, actions, and deeds of the right-wing groups, that our democratic secular institutions, including the educational ones, are being saffronized to a high degree in completely undesirable directions. Speaking truth to power, and that's what I was talking about. Speaking truth to power has transpired in different parts of the world at various stages of the evolution of humanity. And India, too, has contributed to such exemplary exercises in the past quite admirably. I'm saying in the past. Though the phrase speaking the truth to power has existed for quite a while, it gained relatively more currency through the efforts of the Quakers in the United States during the mid-1950s. It was a call for the United States to stand firm against fascism and as a phrase, it is expected to disturb the rightists in a political system. Though in India, we have academic and intellectual voices that do speak truth to power and do indeed take a stand against oppression and exploitation of the deprived sections, we also have witnessed how those who were on the margins of the right or were the so-called centrists or liberals have acquiesced either quietly or at times with fanfare with the state and its bullies on the coming to power of the Hindutva forces subsequent to May 2014. It is indeed sad that speaking truth to power is not considered by many more today to be sine qua non of the civil society in general, in what we call, what we still assume to be a democratic setup that we live in. Another tragic occurrence subsequent to the BJP coming to power is the way many an intellectual and academic has got entrenched with the establishment and identified it totally. Now, this is something I don't know, some of you may have felt, some of the people who are liberal or the centrists, after BJP came to power, they thought that they had legitimacy in order to join the right and take up cudgels. And therefore, during seminars and other places, and something which I don't watch, but I'm told about it quite constantly, I don't watch TV, except the short interview which I gave to NDTV. Okay, so I don't watch TV at all. What I get is all through my readings. And I don't subscribe much to the social media because most people do not have, I think, for some reason or the other, sift through to see what is happening on the social media. Therefore, most of my reading comes from one or two remarkable, still independent kind of publications which we have in the country. Now, the problem which came up as a result of the BJP coming to power was some of the people who are intellectually good have joined the rightists and the BJP or its various kinds of fringe groups and become embedded. Now, that becomes a problem. As an academic or as a social scientist or as a journalist, if you get embedded, you are gone. And during the Iraq war, and subsequently to that also, from 1992 onwards, the American ships carried journalists and gave them hospitality, and those were what I would call embedded journalists. And once you enjoy hospitality, you do not go against the host. Mehman Nawazi aur Mezbani ka bhi kuch chakkar hota hai isme. Isiliye jo hai, once you become embedded, you lose objectivity. And that's why sometimes I also tell my students, particularly and some of my open-minded academic friends, that once you identify yourself with the state or even with a community, you lose certain things which happens to you. Say, for instance, last 4 years when I was in Assam at the Tezpur Central University, one thing which I heard quite constantly was the social scientists, including the sociologists, saying that we Assamese and we in Assam. Now, this is very dangerous. Once you talk about yourself and identify, instead of being a social scientist, identify with a particular community, then you lose certain sense of objectivity in terms of criticizing what's happening. Once I say we, I will be prone not to criticize who all are part of the we. Therefore, it's easy to criticize the other. Now, what happened during the Iraq and Iran war was the embedded journalists which came up. And as a result of that, I think many of the things which reported became a problem. And this is something I think which is happening to the academics in the country today, where they're getting embedded. Once you enjoy hospitality of a certain group, and there are a lot of people with open arms who will accept you if you want to get embedded. Not only that one loses one's voice, but also the distance that is required to take a stance and view things judiciously without the spectacles of the host whose uninhibited benefits and hospitalities enjoyed by one. To say the least, speaking truth to power is in utter short supply in our midst today, and that unfortunately is the truth. And let me give just one example. Some of the governors who are appointed by the BJP, they don't have any independent stance in terms of the various communities, particularly Tripura is one example, for instance, where the Tathagata Roy has been making a fool of himself. And many academics are also making fools of themselves by doing this. Now, in a democratic country, I think everybody has the right to make herself or himself a fool and a stupid person. We are in a democracy. But whether academics should exercise that right to make themselves fools and stupid, that's the question. Thank you very much.
Imtiaz Ahmad defining minorities recently in the last week. who was participating in a seminar. Minorities, you know, it's a centralized decision we have been given. You know, there are the other aspects also for defining minorities. You know, the particular leaders in Karnataka seeking minority status is rising another debate again within the minority. Before she occupies the podium, let me introduce Professor at the Center for Studies in Technology of Education, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, that is TIFF, Mumbai. Specialization works on sociology and related feminism, pluralism, and dynamics. She has published many research papers, many papers including entitled Towards Communal Harmony. Professor Jain, Education for Peace for the Frontline Workers. Professor Jain of the study group constituted the Chief Maharashtra for Ending Backwardness Among Muslims. They also worked on backwardness for Ms. Jagannath Mishra. Along with her regular responsibility and research supervision, Dr. Rekha Jain works actively with an NGO called Center for Society and Secularism in Mumbai. She is the editorial advisory team member of the Indian Journal of Secularism. Brief introduction, call upon Professor Ranu Jain to give her lecture, address.
Professor Kutin, Professor Dr. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Mohammed and the Department of Sociology in MANUU University for inviting me to deliver a lecture on such an interesting culture, language, culture, and minority. I was happy when I got the invitation because in this kind of situation, you sit back and consolidate your idea on a particular theme, and I thought it's giving me a very good opportunity to do that. But I was nervous also because, as I'm coming out in the last two lectures, the theme is extremely complex, and it's not possible to capture all the complexities in a small, short span of 3 minutes. The concept note that Professor Mohammed shared with us, of course, tried to narrow down the theme to the theme of linguistic minority, but he played the mischief by saying, that this has to be considered in sociological, with sociological imagination. And sociological understanding of the issue again starts projecting all the complexities. To share with you all, are the administrative states in India really based on homogeneous linguistic groups? Or is this homogeneity a product of belonging to or an area getting earmarked as a linguistic area? Again, to quote Burdo, it is not space which defines Bordi, I think is the right pronunciation. I always call him Burdo, so you'll have to take it, sorry, at least in the course of next 30 minutes. Okay, to quote Burdo, it is not space which defines language, but language that defines its space. Further questions that can be asked are, who are these linguistic minorities that we are talking about? Are all linguistic groups form linguistic minority or majority? Is the linguistic ethnic group more egalitarian and less fundamentalist than religious groups? And foremost, can linguistic minority be taken as an interest group having political economic concerns? These questions put the issue of language, culture, and minority onto a wider canvas of culture, power, and identity. And I would be referring to the theme in this perspective. I don't have any intention of giving a full-fledged understanding on any one issue the way Professor Kalam has done. Rather, I'm just sharing some of my thoughts and concerns with you all, and I hope that they will be deliberated in with more intensity in the course of 2 days. These thought and issues that I'm projecting are sort of hanging loose, in the sense that all of them require much more discussion and background, which we will be able to tackle in case there is a need, in case from the floor somebody raises the query. I am going to read, and please bear with me because I don't want to waste my 30 minutes with So let me start reading so that I can come back to you all in much more comprehensive manner. Before I begin, I would like to share my experience with one of my students as it brings forth the power of language. I asked her about her feelings on the issue of language, and her immediate response was, "Language is violence." I was taken aback. We all are aware that language is violence, but I was taken aback because it is also a vehicle of communication for peace building. She stated that language is being used to making ideologies, and we cannot deny that, and that legitimizes violence and in fact, instigates people towards using violence, as we have come across in the keynote address by Professor Alam. Instigates people towards using violence, as we are experiencing in the contemporary India. This unfolds symbolic power of language. Language as a tool of expression and communication, of relating to one's own thoughts and feelings, as well as to the collective. Collective to which one belongs, and the collective to which one does not belong, but interacts with in the daily course of action. Okay, but the question is, can we really communicate? When we use a particular word, do we not, again, that has been pointed out by Professor Alam, that the meanings communicate different things depending upon your past history and experience. So what I'm trying to say is that language, in fact, is very much rooted in its local cultural base. Again, that has been pointed out by Professor Alam. But,
Kalam.
Oh, I'm so sorry, Professor Kalam. Okay. What I'm trying to say is that when the language is rooted in the local cultural base, then until and unless we have an idea of we share this cultural base, it becomes difficult to communicate with each other. And this is the most significant aspect of language, the fact that language is rooted into a cultural framework. And this brings forth the Bourdonian concept of cultural capital, which shows that language is extremely inegalitarian. I'm using the word language, but in fact, language doesn't make any sense in itself. It makes sense only when it influences the bearer of language. So linguistic minority majority is implied in this discourse on language throughout. Am I with you all? Okay, thank you. The concept of cultural capital immediately takes language away from the realm of innocent communication with all of its difficulty. Even that innocent communication has its share of difficulty, but it takes it away from even that level of comparatively simpler difficulties to a realm of power dialogue, especially in a multilingual society. Whose language is being used? How comfortable an individual is in using this language? Has she understood the cultural nuances, historical incidents, giving meanings to the words? If you have not understood, believe me, you would sometime or other use different language. okay, or you will not be able to communicate the meaning properly. Like just last week, I used the word holier from Bao, and the person got very angry. She brought me to the entire history of the concept and tried to prove that she is not into holier than thou kind of a experience, without understanding that there is a popular cultural manner in which the term is being used in India. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that it is extremely woven into the culture, the local culture. Although agreeing, I was with the cultural capital. For Burdo, language is an important element of cultural capital, position of which defines possibility of upward mobility in a society. It also defines probability of getting accepted or marginalized or excluded. Although agreeing that all languages possess cultural capital, Burdo specifies that the cultural capital of the dominant is what that counts. But then the question is, how does this dominance happen? Is the dominance based on number, that more people speak a particular dialect, so the dialect becomes more important or more dominant? Is it the son of the soil kind of ideology that helps in defining dominance, or is it just a political dominance? Why and how Hindi became the dominant language in UP at the cost of Maithili and Bhojpuri? Does it not show that sometimes a language becomes dominant because people supporting that language are dominant or significant? Today, political economic scenario does not allow us to take away the significance of market in defining dominant. Then, of course, the language which is closer to market is the dominant language. But then you all can challenge me. If it is only one language, then why are we seeing assertion of so many languages from so many coteries of people? And that I would like to reply in terms of drawing your attention to Jameson's theory that market is multi-layered market. On the top is a global market, which requires an elite or communication basically in English language. Second is the national market, which requires, of course, official language in India is Hindi and English. Then there is regional market, again trying to develop its own monopoly in different regional languages. And of course, ultimately, there's a local market. There we can see the thriving of local dialects, basically. Local dialects. Brass also thinks that language has hierarchy. He has not discussed it in terms of this kind of open market, but he has discussed it in terms of market of language. For him, the first language in India, the top stands Hindi and English, the official languages of Indian Union. Official language in the sense of the technical sense of the word. Second level is of state language recognized in the Schedule 8 and which also have designation of official languages. That is the language of the states, Marathi, Tamil, etc. Okay, at third stage are those languages which are in Schedule 8 but they are not official languages, like Sindhi, like Santhali, like even Sanskrit. Though, of course, now Sanskrit is getting central patronage, so it has its own power dynamics. But the last stage for Brass has not as such mentioned it, but the last stage naturally goes to those languages which are neither in Schedule 8 nor official, who might be fighting for it, who might not be recognized even at that level. And there, I mean, languages like Maithili, Bhojpuri. It's not that these languages may be comparatively less developed. In fact, when Hindi came into being, Maithili was supposed to be the language of UP because it was one of the most developed language there. But the recognition went to Hindi. Okay, once at all levels, I mean at all of these levels of market, languages are well guarded and institutionally protected as well as promoted. Control is exercised on other languages so that not to allow them to come up. The dynamics of minority language lies there also, to not to allow them to come up, mainly because if this language will come up, it may start giving competition and may challenge the monopolitic situation of the official language of the area, with which of course the status of the elite lie. Okay, elite of that particular area, right? By playing the politics of authenticity, there the role of schools, media, TV and everything comes in, and standardizing the language, the hierarchy of elite and people is crystallized. Okay, you're not, like I always remember when I was studying in Calcutta, I was not allowed to speak Bengali, because as soon as I used to start speaking Bengali, my friends used to say, "Tumi shadhu bangla bolcho na." If you are not speaking correct language, please shut up. You can use English, you can use Hindi, but you can't use our Bengali. What happened? Ultimately, I'm still very weak in Bengali. Anyway, that is a different point. This inequality strengthens when language interface with religion and class. Best example is the example of Urdu. Despite Muslim population being around 14% in India, Urdu as an official language is only in Jammu and Kashmir, one state, and as a additional official language is in Bihar, Jharkhand and UP, perhaps Telangana also, no? Yeah, Telangana also. Although Urdu sher and shairi are still very popular. I don't know how many of us understand, I love hearing it, that's for sure. Urdu's sher and shairis are very popular. The rich language has virtually got reduced to medium of instruction in schools, and the Urdu language bearer are one of the most deprived and marginalized people in India. However, I feel, I'm not talking about the heterogeneity which one sees in the case of Urdu speakers. I know that non-Muslims also speak, but I'm talking about the dominant population, basically the population of poor Sunni. Okay. I feel that language is an instrument for developing ethnic or minority identity. Language is not as strong as religion, as religions are guarded by grand ideologies which are otherworldly and address uncertainties that as such cannot be challenged. Okay, I cannot challenge that in my earlier birth, I have not done anything to bear the suffering that I'm bearing today. And somewhere that uncertainty, that element of doubt remains, and so we accept, we feel, what are we losing by accepting it? There the strength of religion as grand theory lies, which is not with language. So, language, people may give way, people may give up their local language and dialects for more lucrative market language, as is being seen especially in urban India. Before initiating a discussion on linguistic minorities, I would like to state that no such discussion can take place as if there are no contesting wise voices. In fact, the democracy of India has many contesting voices giving different meanings and interpretation and different value frameworks for people to stand on. And people are always sort of oscillating, sometimes on the basis of their political interest, vested interest, sometimes taking a secular stand, sometimes taking a ethnic stand, sometimes negating linguistic unification, sometimes advocating it. I personally feel that if we have to look at the question of language, culture and minority, or language, power and identity, we have to take into account two contesting ideologies. One is the modern secular liberal ideology promoting interest of individual citizens, where it is more better if you take market language. rather than the local language. And second is the contesting thing is the ethnic collective ideology supposedly promoting a primordial identity which was earlier taken as cultural lack to be dissolved with the modern discourse. So what I'm trying to say is that if there are this kind of ideology, and then if a set of people are taking a stand towards language or linguistic identity, then it is their conscious choice. And there lies the importance of identity dynamics, minority dynamics. Why this conscious choice is being made? I personally feel that this conscious choice is being made in an era of ethnic politics, because identity somewhere has got linked with the state recognition by the civil society, and of course with the linked logic of distribution of resources. If you belong to the logic of representation in legislation, the logic of representation in so many other bodies, in public sphere. Okay, so there lies the strength of identity, I personally feel. And so I feel that if people are making this conscious choice of belonging to a linguistic identity, then they are making it consciously, and then we will have to move away from the realm of anthropology to sociology to understand why are they finding this kind of identity is very meaningful and beneficial for them. Of course, in the case of minority language, one can understand that this has come because it is linked with the powerful control on states, but it will be impertinent to state here that this kind of choices, assertive choices, rational choices are generally made at the level of leader, while the people may follow it basically because, not because of their vested interest, but with emotional pride of belonging. We can, as I was saying, various markets and various levels of dealing with this kind of complex situation. Ethnicity, I feel, is a very interesting interplay between a sense of belonging to a culture and use of that sense of belonging and pride by the community leaders for political power, for political purpose of gaining power. The Indian Constitution recognizes only two ascriptive bases for attributing the status of minority: religion and language. However, it neither specifies what is a minority nor specifies what is religion and language. It has left it on the courts to specify these. The kind of ambiguity that one sees in the case of specification and religious minority, one does not see in the case of language, because somehow or other the kind of tension that religion has given us at the time of partition, language has not. So, in case of language, things are comparatively better. Like in one of the court, DAV College Jalandhar, as early as 1971, it was stated that even spoken language can have the status of minority. Example is Marwari. Okay, but interestingly, later on, Parliament took the decision that even a developed language may not take the status of a minority if it is not supported by popular movement. What I'm trying to say is that all these decisions were being made in the framework of unity and diversity, as has been already pointed out to you all. And in the case of unity and diversity, because the main agenda with our leaders was the agenda of nation building, diversity part has been underplayed or managed, pacified, rather than promoted. Though we always take very pride in taking a model of multiculturalism in India, but there are strong gaps in this model. Anyway, the numerical criteria of deciding on minority was sort of accepted criteria, but Along with it, the important clauses were the clauses of backwardness and disadvantage. Now, with the ethnic politics coming in, this latter clause seems to have got lost, and ethnicity, including linguistic minority and religious, sorry, linguistic groups and religious groups, are sort of, you know, going vying for political power, and so Jains are asking for minority status, and so many linguistic groups are also asking for minority status. Now, minority identity has become synonymous to excess of to power and resources. Although the Indian constitution is supposed to have similar approach towards both the linguistic minority and the religious minority, it does not appear to have done so. Both minorities, Indian constitution has taken a stand that it is giving sort of a Ambedkar. Basically, I mean, if you read the Indian Constituent Assembly debates, you will see that he has taken a stand that basically we are giving a space for those who want to continue or promote their culture to allow them to continue and promote their culture, rather than state coming and helping them towards promoting their culture. And hence, one does not come across any case of any kind of development measures being taken for religious minorities by Indian constitution. However, the scenario is different in the case of linguistic minority, in the sense that with Schedule 8, the government is committed to protect the development of, or to work towards the development of the languages that are recognized in Schedule 8, and official language. Once a linguistic province or linguistic state comes into being, then the entire power goes into that linguistic group, not only to manage its cultural promotion, its linguistic promotion, but also to manage its socioeconomic development. So lots of power, and they have lots of resources, even from the central government, to manage these affairs. So this is one of the basic differences between the linguistic minority and religious minority. Just one second. Government concern for national integration, however, was equally applicable on both the linguistic and the religious minority. According to Brass, and I will quote, Brass has stated that in that four formal and informal rules have been developed by central government to deal with linguistic minorities. The first rule was that the central government would not recognize groups that are making secessionist demands. And that is why Tamil Nadu and in many northeast states, the statehood was not given till they let go of the secessionist demand. And after that, of course, they got the statehood. The second point was that state will not accommodate regional demand only on the based on religious differences. If there is any kind of, you know, linguistic movements developing, somewhere camouflaging or overshadowing the, or with the purpose of promoting the religious movement, then state was hesitant to acknowledge or give statehood to such minorities. Example can be given of Punjabis who did not get Punjab till the change of leadership in 60s, which convinced the state that the religious connotation of the movement is under control. Third is, demand for linguistic state will be accommodated only when it has public support, or in practical terms, it is followed by a linguistic movement. That objective language differences would not suffice for a demand for reorganization to succeed was also demonstrated in the northern part of Bihar province, where a culture and literary elite demanded the creation of a separate province for speakers of Maithili, a language distinct from both Hindi and Bengali speakers who were neighbor of this language. The fourth point was, central government will not agree to reorganization of a province if the demand was made by only one of the important language groups concerned. Example, reorganization of Madras happened only once it was backed by both Tamilian and Telugu people. Otherwise, it would not have happened. I mean, so state government was overall working on the unity into diversity kind of a framework, which has affected the dynamics of the linguistic ethnic groups. For me, the most important dimension of linguistic identity is its ethnic identity, suffering from all the shortcomings and gains of ethnic identity. The power of linguistic identity rests on its having a specific primordial, social, cultural, and geographical identity. It enjoys a feeling of fellowship for one's own kith and kin, and a feeling of consciousness of kind which binds together, which is very important to function and for governance also. However, one essential difference between an ethnic group and a class category lies in the fact that the former, that is the ethnic groups, the linguistic groups, thrive on we and they feeling. Perception of difference in relation to others, whether that other is the state or rival ethnic community, is what consolidates ethnic identity. Linguistic groups, just like other ethnic groups, are engineered facts. Burdo states that neither dialects nor languages have natural limits. These limits get fixed within ethnic boundaries, which means maybe any territory which gets demarcated as the territory of that linguistic group. As soon as that happens, language starts consolidating. Official language gets defined. Institution of the region like schools and media starts consolidating the language mainly by linking language with job allocation and official function. The language gets declared as a medium of instruction in schools. More and more such schools starts getting established. Publication, film, TV serials in the official language gets strengthened, and which marginalizes and weakens other minority languages existing in the area, because of the, not only because of sheer lack of resources, but also because of the sheer lack of will in the case of followers, because it's more lucrative to follow official language. In the construction of we and them, we consolidates across class and religion groups, while them perish without much support. Even if government gives support for promotion of certain minority languages, political economy focusing on the official language does not allow the minority languages to develop. Over time, the process of territorial redemarcation of state affects the powers and privileges of the ruling elite, redefining the ruling elite and their power. Language always have a political process of unification, whereby a determinate set of speaking subject, that is the people who start following the language, is led in practice to accept the official language. It creates a unified linguistic market. I'm bringing in Ambedkar over and over again because Ambedkar was very important in the nation building as well as in the entire discourse on minority, whether we are talking about linguistic or religious. So Ambedkar was aware of the danger of linguistic majoritarianism and minoritism arising out of complex processes of political patronage and protection offered to dominant linguistic communities at the time of state formation. He alerted on the dangerous separatist tendencies that one can witness in the nations and nationalities founded on the basis of race and language exclusively. Brass supports Ambedkar. In contrast to the pluralist policies pursued by the Government of India, many of the states have pursued discriminatory policies towards their linguistic minorities within their boundaries. Moreover, the centre has been unable to protect such minorities effectively against the opposition of the state government concerns. Among the casualties, for example, have been Urdu in the North Indian state and the various so-called mother tongue or dialects of Hindi and other, even in the South Indian places. The above discussion should not look at the, the above discussion should not mean as if I'm looking at the linguistic minorities or linguistic groups in total negativity. We cannot forget that India inequality has sociocultural manifestation. These inequality get ignored if not increased in the process of consolidation of linguistic states or any kind of linguistic or ethnic base of social organization, because ethnic base believes in homogenization by either not allowing the differences to prevail, but also by might be assimilating the different strands into one syncretic, into one homogeneous identity. In such cases, linguistic movements with their promise of establishing linguistic administrative units can help in ensuring development of some marginalized population, as has been seen in the case of Telangana, in fact. It promises bringing governance to the earlier deprived population and extends autonomy to the population to manage its own affairs in accordance to their local language and culture. With the state and central resources, only problem is that ethnic movements, that is including linguistic minorities, linguistic groups and religious groups, do not address structures of inequality but ask for their share in the appropriated state resources. That means that the process of marginalization may shift from one group to another, but in this kind of discourse, it continues. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ranu. It's a very interesting lecture you have given. We understand that, you know, reconstruction of post-independent nation has taken place more or less on linguistic lines, thus calling it to a federal structure. But this language continues to be creating a social rupture, social tensions in the society. Thus, the language in the diversified society like India continues to occupy the central theme, focal theme. So, as you said, these debates go on, and we, the sociologists, social linguistics disciplines are there to address the issues which are coming up time and again. Thank you once again. Now it's time for word of thanks. I request my colleague Dr. Sahid to come and offer formal word of thanks. Before that, I'll make a small announcement. After ending up this session, we'll have tea and come back quickly to reassemble in this hall to attend the session, plenary session.
I thank Professor Jacob John, chief guest of this inaugural session, to come to grace the occasion, sir. And thank you, sir, for taking your time out of your schedule to be with us today. And I have no hesitation to say, sir, that your presence, with your presence and with your participation, and we have got a very splendid beginning of this international conference. And you have prominently raised the issues of homogenization, the danger which is coming from the state and market. And I think it is market, and actually if I use this Foucauldian terminology discourse, we are actually we are all acting within discourse, and there is no escape. And language actually have this real danger from this market system, because the English is accelerating and dominating all the languages. And thank you, sir, for being with us today. And I also thank Professor Kalam to grace the occasion and delivering the keynote address. And he quite rightly advocated this theme that there should be some activism in the academics. So and we actually differ from this textbook analysis of the issues of language, issues of identity, and the issue of the when we talk about the case of the minorities. And he quite prominently raised the issues of extrajudicial attack, the lynching, the issues of this vigilantism in the country. And I think this is rightfully, and I think there should be a case for counter hegemonic movement, which sir said is more or less coming from the lower caste or the marginalized sections. Thank you so much, sir, for thought-provoking lecture today. And I also thank Professor Renu Jain, our guest of honor today for this session. Ma'am, your presence and participation add great value for this conference. And you rightfully raised the issues of the Bourdieu's notion of the cultural capital, and also linked the market and the language. And I think we will be taking some of these critical issues in our some of the sessions in the conference. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being with us today. And I also thank all the delegates who have come from different parts of the country to participate and present the papers. And I thank really, especially Dr. Srinivas Rao in absentia, though he is not here today. He will be joining us tomorrow. He has actually, helped us academically, and when we actually conceptualize the whole idea of this language, culture, and minorities or the identities. And I also thank Dr. Sumit Srivastava. He's sitting here, my friend from Allahabad University. He also helped us giving and give feedback on the concept note. And very importantly, I thank Sir P.H. Mohammed, our head of the department and convener of this conference, who quite proactively and it is because of actually his dedication and commitment that we took up this challenge of organizing this conference in a very short span of time. And it is because of his efforts and his actually activeness that we actually get connected with the experts of the academic, like Professor Dr. John, Professor M.A. Kalam, Professor Renu Jain, and many more delegates, Sting, Professor Pamela Madam, and all. So thank you so much, sir. And actually being part of his team, I could observe him the way actually he was engaged almost all the time. He was on the phone, engrossed in reading the mails and replying to the people and convincing the resource persons. Actually, he set aside his personal life and all, actually in the middle of the night sending us mail, and then the feedback on the invitation and banner and calling us. We actually so much actually engaged in the entire process, and it is because of Professor P.H. Mohammed, he led his team quite smoothly and very actively. Thank you so much, and thank you so much, Shazia, welcoming the guest. And I also thank Dr. Ehtisham Akhtar, my colleague and part of the organizing committee, conference organizing committee. You both are really very outstanding person and very wonderful colleagues and very dedicated professionals who are actually always ready and always available to work beyond office hours. And thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, Shri and Ehtisham. And I also thank our honorable vice chancellor, though due to some contingency he is not available with us, and our PVC pro vice chancellor Professor Akil Ahmed, and our registrar Dr. M.A. Sikandar, for all the help they provided us in both administrative or financial, and all the support they provided us. I really offer my wholehearted thanks to them. And I'm very thankful to our office staff, Mohammed Imtiaz and Sheikh Ahmed, who have sincerely worked with us day and night to make this event happen. And actually, I offer our take this office staff, he takes just a minute to create the file, and not only create a file, like just like for the conference, he sincerely actually take it forward. He's very committed to the department. Thank you, Sheikh. And I'm also thankful to the ground heroes, like our research scholars, our MA students, Usman, Mustaq Ahmed, Aisha, Masarat, Afreen, Jilani, Shafia, Shibli, Azim, Irshad, and others would help us and also acted to organize all the activities of the conference and support us in all in various ways. I once again sincerely thank all the dignitaries on the dais and head and our dean, Professor Sahida, our delegates and colleagues and friends and students for your presence and participation. Thank you so much, everybody.